Okay, so we have only one. Varun Sai, are you new, Kana?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's nice. Which school are you from?
Shankara, sir.
Okay, that's nice. That's nice. So we'll just wait for people to join. It's almost 7:05. I don't know why nobody's there.
Yes, sir.
Do you know these people who are already attending classes here?
Sir, some of them.
Some of them you know. Okay, nice. And hope you know, right? Like, you have the recordings already of the previous two chapters. Yeah, there have been two chapters completed, right? And you'll be able to find right recordings, right? Cool. If you have any doubts, you can personally approach me also, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, cool. Guys, if you have people's number, please call them and wake them up. There are only 1, 2, 3, 4 people. In another minute we'll start, guys. In 7:08 we'll start. Okay, guys, we'll go start right away. I'll share my screen. Okay, so I think you're able to see my screen. So yeah, we have completed two chapters, isn't it, guys? So we completed general organic chemistry, right? And we completed chemical bonding also, right? So now we'll start with the physical chapter. We completed one organic, one inorganic. So let us start something physical. And I would say in 11th, the most interesting chapter, according to me, in physical chemistry, right? And that would be my... thermodynamics, right? Fine. I don't know how much you have learned in your 11th class, but say your knowledge point of view or your marks point of view, number of questions point of view in your JEE, yeah, I will get good number of questions from this particular chapter. Okay, right? It's logical as well as you need to use a lot of formulas in this chapter, right? And I'll be able to divide this chapter into three parts, right? So first part talks about the first law of thermodynamics and zeroth law, right? And second part will be about thermochemistry, right? That there we are going to deal only with enthalpies. And third part is going to talk about the second and third law of thermodynamics, right? But that third part is pretty small, right? The first part is the first two parts are okay. We'll be able to manage, right? Okay, so starting with it, we know what this term means, thermodynamics, right? So thermo is heat, right? Dynamics is movement, right? So we are going to study about heat movement from one body to another body, or say heat transfer from one body to another body, but not per se exactly transfer. But yeah, the basic... the basic information regarding that, yes, you'll be studying in there, right? So we know we're talking about heat movement. So obviously we have to talk about heat movement across something, right? So what is that across something? First of all, whenever you're going to approach some problem in thermodynamics, right? First thing what you have to set up is something called as a boundary, right? So you are saying that... the heat is going to move from, say, one place to another place. So obviously you need to have a boundary. So crossing that boundary, the heat will flow, right? So obviously there'll be something of interest for you inside the boundary, and whatever is outside the boundary, we are not much interested in, right? So inside the boundary, what is called a system. When I write S bar M, is called system. And what is outside the boundary is what is called as my surroundings. So these and all are the common definition which we know, right? So system is where, like, what interest, like which place of or area where I lay my interest upon, right? Say the system can be the entire universe, right? System can be a small atom. System can be my whole body, or say in my body, the heart alone can be a system. So it's all about where you set the boundary. There is no restriction that this only can be the boundary or this only can be the system. There is nothing like that. According to the problem, right? You will choose your boundaries and accordingly you will choose your systems, right? Okay, so now when I go for types of system, right? Obviously, we have four different types of system, I can say, right? So first one is what is called as open systems. And I have something called as closed systems. I'll write it down. Right? I have something called as... So I have something called as... oh God, some problem is happening. Adiabatic systems, or say, now I'll say isolated, then we'll go for adiabatic. Right. Isolated, and lastly, I have something called as adiabatic system, right? So it's pretty simple if you try to understand logically what it would be: open, closed, isolated, and adiabatic. Right. Say the example I can give you for open systems, right? So open system, the example I can give you is, say you are having a vessel of water, right? And say you start heating and you're gonna boil it, right? So now what you see there, you see that the energy transfer is happening, in the sense from your source of heat, or say your stove or whatever it is, the heat is getting transferred to the system. The system, in a sense, the vessel of water, right? So the heat is getting transferred, as well as what you see is that after a point of time, some amount of water would have gotten lost,
right? So in an open system, I would say, how do you perfectly define it is that I'm going to have both mass transfer as well as heat transfer. That's the best way of putting it. So heat transfer is happening from the source to your system, and mass transfer is also happening. The amount of water is keeping on changing throughout the process, right? Okay, now same when I go for closed system, right? Now you take the same example, you're gonna boil water, but just only one condition. The condition is that you are gonna keep the lid, the top layer, the top surface, open surface closed, right? You're gonna heat it with everything closed, totally sealed vessel, I would say, right? So obviously now you can say that the heat transfer will happen because you're still heating it, but the amount of water, right? But the amount of water will not change, isn't it? So mass transfer will not happen in case of a closed system, right? Because it's closed, the mass cannot escape, right? But heat transfer can happen, right? Now, when I go for isolated, as I told you, both mass transfer, I mean, neither mass transfer nor heat transfer is going to happen. It's like a glass of water, you just keep it at the corner of the table. Nothing is going to change. No heat transfer, no mass transfer, right? Okay. Now, when I go for adiabatic systems, right? Now, adiabatic systems, I think the example I can give you is all the thermo flasks you can have, right? So you can say, okay, obviously you can see that the mass transfer can happen here. So what I'm telling is you can have mass transfer, yes, but there should not be any heat transfer. That's the perfectly, I would say, a perfect adiabatic system. So obviously, why do you use your flasks, right? You want to retain the hotness of the coffee or tea or whatever, or water or whatever it is. You want to retain the heat for a longer period of time, right? So that's what, so basically an insulated system is what is called as an adiabatic system. The heat cannot go in, the heat cannot go out, but mass can change. Right, so that's about your adiabatic systems. Okay, so fine. So now, if you want to describe a system, people, right? If you want to talk about a system, say, for example, you want to describe me, right? So now, I know you wouldn't have seen me, like at least not fully. You would have seen a part of me in the cameras, right? So and I will tell that, say, you are, I'm tall. I used to have a beard. Say, dark complexioned, stupid, right? So all these things are the all these are the words, all these adjectives you'll use for describing a person, right? So same way, if you want to talk about a particular system, there are certain things which you're going to use, like you're going to use something to describe a system, to study about the system, right? So those are what are called as properties of the system, right? Now, what properties I have? Basically, I'm tall, I'm having a mustache, all these things, right? So those are what are called as properties of a system. So basically, why are we using properties? If you want to describe a system, if you want to study about the systems, or say, if you want to predict how the system will behave in the future, right? So all these things, if you want to know, you have to know the properties of the system, okay? And these properties can again be divided into two categories. One is what is called as intensive properties or intensive variables, I call them, right? The other one is what is called as extensive properties or extensive variables of the system, right? Okay, so what can be intensive? What can be extensive? Now, intensive variables are going to be independent of the mass, independent of amount is the better way, right? So it is going to be independent of the amount of substance present inside the system. Right. Say, for example, temperature is one thing. Right. So it doesn't matter if I have 100 grams of water, 200 grams of water. But what matters is how much temperature I have. It really doesn't matter. Right. Say, other thing I can tell you is density. Right. So people think like density is equal to mass by volume. So it definitely depends on the amount, but it's not like that. It's mass per unit volume. Right. You are making sure that there is only one. There is one ml of, or 1 liter, 1 unit volume. In that 1 unit volume, how much mass I have. So again, keeping the volume constant, the mass will again change, obviously, right? So the thing is, the density again will be an intensive property. Okay, so that, so hope you understand what you mean by intensive property. They are even your pressure also comes under intensive properties, right? Okay, so hope you understand what even the intensive properties, they are going to be independent of the amount of substance inside the system, right? And obviously the opposite, extensive properties are going to be dependent, right? Say there can be numerous examples for this. Say volume is a good example. All energies, right? All, I'm just putting E. It can be energies, means it can be Q, it can be delta enthalpy, it can be internal energy U, right? So any type of energy you deal with, right, all of them will actually be extensive properties. And even your work done, right, we'll speak about in depth about all of these, don't worry, right? So, and even your number of moles, concentrations, all these things come under extensive properties, okay, whichever is going to depend upon the amount of substance present in this, inside the system, right? Okay, now thermodynamics being a wonderful tool, right, it's a very powerful tool in a sense. why I tell you that is a very powerful this thing is that the amount of information you require, basically you want to do something, you want to study about a system, right? You want to predict how the system will behave in the future if I give some amount of heat and all that, right? What thermodynamics helps me out, how thermodynamics helps me out is that the amount of information we require, right, is pretty less, right? But the amount of information which we will get, right, that will be enormous, right? So thermodynamics takes in very less information but gives us more information. that's the advantage of using thermodynamics, right? The amount of information it takes in is very less, right, but the amount of information it is going to give you about the particular system is really going to be enormous, right? Now how will I give a reason to this, right? Now please understand, people, if you want to know anything and everything about the system, in the sense that you want to go for 100% description, there is nothing that you will know, you don't know about the system, you know anything and everything about the system, right? So if you want to know that, if you want to do that, if you want to know, if you want to do the 100% description of the system, right, now there are only three things which are required for this particular thing, right, for this 100% description, right, you require only three things about the system, right? So what is that? You require the number of moles of the particular compound or say the particular substance present in the system. You need the N value, that is the number of moles, right? And also you require two intensive properties, okay, right? So say for example, if you know temperature and density, right, and you know the number of moles, right, that's it. You actually know everything about the system. Okay, like obviously we, through the help of formulas or to some other physical connections, you will be able to know actually everything about the system, right? Okay, now the question is, sir, now okay, you told me that this is fine, right, number of moles is required, two intensive properties are required, but or not, like will I be given always the intensive properties, right? Will I be always given only intensive properties for me to work on with? The answer is no. Sometimes they can even give you extensive properties, right? So how do you deal with it? Right, now it's pretty simple, because you will be able to convert an extensive property into an intensive property, right? So even though an extensive property is given to you, right, there is a way by which you can convert that extensive property into an intensive property, right? Now how do you do that? It's pretty simple. Now if you want the intensive property, right, and if extensive property is given to you, EP is your extensive property, right? Now what you do is you just divide the extensive property by the number of moles. That's it, right? So now the given extensive property, if it divided by the number of moles, it actually becomes an intensive property. Let me give you an example. So I told you energies, where we generally deal with joules, correct? Right? So energies, we generally deal with joules. The unit of energy is joules. But I don't know whether you have noticed it. We always speak energy, like especially at least in thermodynamics or in all the things, whatever seen in chemistry, right? We actually do it as joules per mole, kilojoules per mole, kilocalories per mole, right? So what you're doing there, basically you are dividing the energy by the number of moles, right? You are dividing the energy by the number of moles, right, so that it becomes an intensive property, right? So that's why all the heat, let it be heat or enthalpy or even your internal energy, whatever it is, right, actually you are going to deal it in terms of joules per mole. That means dividing by the number of moles and making it an intensive property. Same goes with volume, right? So if you divide volume by number of moles, right? If you divide volume by number of moles, it is going to become something called as molar volume, right? Now, why are we doing this? How is it that it is getting converted? It's because now that you have, like, say, extensive properties depend on the amount, right? Now you are making sure that particular amount is constant. How is it constant? For one mole of that particular compound, what is the value? So we are making sure that amount is constant, right? So obviously, since you're making sure the amount is constant, that is only one mole. So obviously it eventually becomes an intensive property. Okay, right? So these are things about intensive and extensive properties. Is that okay? All right, fine. Now there is one more way of classification. These properties or these variables, which I'm talking about, right? So one way of classifying them is with this intensive and extensive properties, right? Now the other way of doing it, let me add a page. Right now, the other way of doing it, the classifying them, again, I'll write just write properties. Right, or say it's better word to use here would be variables. Right, so these variables. One way of classification is the previous one, intensive and extensive. The other way is like this. It's like something called as state variables. And the other one is what is called as path variables, right? So state variables and path variables. Now, what do you mean by this? Right, fine. So people, please understand, when I say state, so you might have also heard statements like this. The system goes from one state to another state. You must have heard about this, right? Or say an atom goes from this state to another state, something like that, right? So what do you mean by this state, right? Nothing. One state to another state means one condition to another condition. In the sense, say initially I will have P1, V1, T1 as the pressure, volume, and temperature. Say in the second state, I will have P2, V2, and T2 as the conditions, as the pressure, volume, and temperature. So when I say state, basically I'm talking about what are the conditions in which the system is present. What is the pressure? What is the volume? What is the temperature? Right? Okay. So, okay. That is what you mean by state. Right. Now, what do you mean by a state variable? Right. Now, when I say state variable, see, understand, the best example I can give you to differentiate between these two, that is your state variables and path variables, is that you take the example, you take some physical, like if you want to see the some easy example, the example can be distance, right? And you can take displacement, right? So we know what is the basic difference between these two, right? I know distance is a scalar quantity, displacement is a vector quantity. No, but that's not what I think you're talking about here, right? So distance, now please understand, if I put a graph, say I want to reach from this point to this point, okay? I want to reach from this point, this initial point to this point, right? So now I can take numerous values, right? Say I can take the path to be, one second, guys. Right. So I can take the path to be something like this. I can reach either way. I can take so whatever I want. I can do whatever I want. Whatever path I can go. Right. So now, however you go, right? Obviously, if you take different paths, right, the distance will be different, right? But displacement will still be the same. Right? Why? Because we say that displacement is the shortest distance between two points. Right? What is shortest distance? The shortest distance is this. The shortest distance is actually going to be the straight line. So the straight line always determines the displacement. Right? So what you understand here, distance actually depends on what path you take. Right? What is the path taken? Accordingly, the distance will change. But displacement, now you've given the initial point and the final point. Initial point is given, the final point is given. Displacement is set. It is not going to change. Right? So that is what do you mean by state and path variables. Path variables, the value will change depending on how you do the process. In the sense, how, say you have state one, you have state two, path variables are going to depend upon how you are reaching from state one to state two, right? But your state variables just depends on what is the state one and what is the final state. And it doesn't matter how you reach there. However you reach there, whatever path you take, right? Those values, those variables, those state variables are going to have the same value. Okay. Hope you understand what you mean by state and path variables. State variables just depends on the initial and final states. Path variables also depends on the path taken from the initial to the final state. Okay. Now, thermodynamically speaking, what can be examples of state variables? All your energy values, basically, I would say not all energies, your enthalpy value, delta H, delta G, even your delta E. Delta E is internal energy, right? So all these things are actually going to be my state variables. This just depends on the initial and final state. It really doesn't matter how I reach there, right? And path variables, example, can be heat, work, right? All these can be examples of path variables. It actually depends on, it doesn't matter. I mean, it also matters what is the initial and final state, but other than that, how you reach from one point to another point, how you reach from one state to another state also matters for these variables. Okay, fine. So these are all the things, the introduction part, which you have to know. Okay, now we'll move on, right? Now, what we'll try to do is that we will try to establish a relationship between your heat and temperature. Okay, now we know, right? What we know, heat is different, temperature is different, right? When I say temperature, right? When I say temperature, we know we call it as it is the measure of hotness or coldness of a body, right? But heat, right? Heat is the amount of energy. Heat is the energy, and temperature is the measure of how hot or how cold the body is, right? So if we can actually establish some kind of a mathematical relationship between temperature and the heat, right? It is actually going to be really helpful, right? So what I can understand from your logical explanation, please understand, people. I have a body at, say, 50 degrees Celsius, right? And there is another body at 100 degrees Celsius, okay? Right? So now when I keep them together, right? When I keep them together, obviously what will happen? The heat will start flowing from the hotter body to the colder body. So basically the heat will flow from the 100 degrees Celsius body to the 50 degrees Celsius body, right? So now obviously it will not happen throughout, right? It is not like it's going to happen continuously. It is going to stop at a point of time, right? So it is going to stop. Can you tell me at what time the heat flow will stop? Anybody?
When it reaches equilibrium.
Right. So yeah, that's the point. Like when I say that, when the amount of heat of this and the amount of heat of this becomes equal, right? Now they are at two different heat contents. Or in other words, if the temperature of this and the temperature of this and this becomes equal, again the heat will stop. Right? Okay. So that we what is called it as thermal equilibrium. Right? That particular state, when no heat flow happens, there is no net heat flow, right? So that condition is what is called as thermal equilibrium, right? So again, in the next chapter, or not meant to be next chapter, actually, if you are in 11th, after thermodynamics, I would have thought to equilibrium only, but still now we will not take it because next is all, that is also a physical chemistry chapter. But anyways, so equilibrium in a sense, there is going to be no change in the heat content, okay? Right? So fine. So actually, before we move on to see the relationship between Q and T, that is heat and temperature, actually, I can speak about this thermal equilibrium for a while, because your zeroth law of thermodynamics. Right? Your zeroth law of thermodynamics actually talks about this thermal equilibrium only. Okay, now zeroth law of thermodynamics is also called as this one, Right. So again, okay, I think you read what I read, what I wrote here. Right. It's also called as common sense law. Right. So scientists actually for fun, so they use this term also, common sense law, for zeroth law, because it's pretty easy to understand. Anybody with little common sense, right, will be actually able to understand what is the zeroth law. And I think I already know the statement for this, right? But anyways, we'll just look into it. Right. Say if I have three bodies. Right. So I have three bodies, right? Say now I'll just call three bodies as A, B, C. Right. So now what I say is that if you find that A and B are in thermal equilibrium, that means what? There is no heat flow happening between A and B. Right. And if you find that A and C are also in thermal equilibrium, in the sense that there is no heat flow happening between A and C also. Right. Now, individually, A and B are in equilibrium. Individually, A and C are in equilibrium. And it's pretty much easy, and it's pretty much a use of common sense, that there will definitely be not, there will be definitely no heat flow between B and C also. In the sense, B and C will also is going to be in thermal equilibrium. Okay. Right. So now maybe you will not be able to appreciate the statement. Right. But when it actually came out, I don't know, I think in 1800s or even before that, right, people were mesmerized. Oh, is that the case? Because, please, like at that time, how many theories and how many laws we have, that time it was not like that. So even though it's a pretty simple statement, right, but at the point of time when it actually came, right, it had a very huge effect. Right. So this is what is called zeroth law of thermodynamics. A and B are in equilibrium. A and C are in equilibrium. It is understood that B and C are also going to be in equilibrium, right? Okay, so this is small thing about thermal equilibrium. Let me add a page, we'll continue. Right, okay. So as I told you, we will try to get a relationship between your heat and temperature. Okay, now guys, please understand, we say that heat is flowing from a hotter body to the colder body. Is it not, right? So now please, okay. Now tell me this, I have two bodies, at 50 degrees Celsius and 100 degrees Celsius, right? Now this is case one. Now if I give you case two, say I have first body at 50 degrees Celsius, right? And say the second body at 500 degrees Celsius. Okay, now tell me in which case the heat flow will be more.
Second case,
obviously, right? Now you have, now this is the first body's temperature is same, but then in the two cases the second body's temperature is different. In second case it's 500 degrees Celsius, so obviously the heat flow which is going to happen here, say if I call it as Q1, say it's Q2, and say if I call it as Q1, right? So obviously what you understand is more is the difference in temperature, more is the difference in hotness of the two bodies, more and more will be the heat flow, right? So obviously what I can understand from here, Q2 is without any doubt is going to be greater than Q1, right? So from this, I think I'll be able to give you the statement now, any Q, I can tell that is going to be directly proportional to the change in temperature. Is it not? So you can see that a change in temperature is only 50, but here the change in temperature is 450. Right. So obviously I can say that the amount of heat flowing, right, is definitely going to be directly proportional to the change in temperature, delta T. Right. So now for removing the proportionality sign, I can bring in a constant. Right. So this Q is going to be equal to, again, now please understand that this Q is actually going to be an extensive property or extensive variable. So it has to depend upon the amount. Okay, fine. So let me come back to that later. So now if I just remove the proportionality sign, I just have to put a constant. I'll put the constant as C. So I'll just call it as C delta. Okay, now this C is one of the most important constants, right? So this C is what is called as your heat capacity. Right? Now heat capacity. Now heat capacity will be different for different gases or different substances. Okay, so heat capacity of N2 will be different. Heat capacity of ammonia will be different, right? Okay, so this heat capacity, this is what is called as heat capacity, right? So now Now, as I told you, this Q is actually an extensive property. Okay. Now, I'll be able to write two equations, right, depending on what type of amount you're going to use. Okay. So, now I can write as Q is equal to MC del T. And I can also write Q is equal to NC del T. So, basically, here I'm using mass. Right. And here I'm using moles. That's the only difference, right? Now, accordingly, how you define your heat capacity will also change, right? So in this case, in the first case, since you're using mass, now this heat capacity is what is called as mass heat capacity, right? HC, right? It's called mass heat capacity. And in this case, since you're using number of moles, here it is going to be called as molar heat capacity because you're using moles, right? Fine. So depending on what amount you use, whether you use mass or whether you use number of moles, the name of the heat capacity will also be different. If you use mass, it's called mass heat capacity. If you use number of moles in the Q equation, it's going to be called as molar heat capacity. Okay, right. So now we'll try to define it. Okay, so we'll try to define, molar heat. Now, at least in chemistry, right, we will not be using this much mass. Right, we will not be using much. 99% of times we will be going only with your molar heat capacity. Okay, this first one you'll be majorly using in physics. Right? When I go to physical thermodynamics, right, at that time maybe you will be using MC del T more than NC del T because obviously physicist doesn't like moles, right? So most of the time we'll be using only the second equation, that is Q is equal to NC del T. So the heat capacity which we'll be using is molar heat capacity, not mass heat capacity. Okay, right, fine. Now, this thing can tell me for the first one, for the first equation, what will be the unit of heat capacity? Or if I ask you, what is the unit of mass heat capacity? What will be your answer? Maybe putting something in the chat. Nothing, I guess. Okay, I hope you understood my question, right? I'm asking you, what is the unit of mass heat capacity? Yes, you can look at the equation and you can tell, right? You must have done dimensional analysis in 11th class. You know how to get the... What is that? Units of different substances, different variables. What is the answer? Oh, yeah. In the chat, something is there. Joule per Kelvin. Okay. Siddharth, always remember, I should only use SI units. Joule per kilogram, correct. But for temperature, please understand that it is going to be Kelvin. Okay. So, yeah, Harini, your answer is correct. Right, it's going to be joule per Kelvin per mole. Joule per kilogram per Kelvin. Yes, that's the answer. Right, so hope everybody can understand here. Right, so for mass heat capacity, here it is going to be joules. So you can see here, joules will be there, and for M, it's kg, and for temperature, it is Kelvin. All right, so it's going to be joule per Kelvin per mole, or not mole, here it is mass, so it is going to be per kg. Right, that will be the unit of mass heat capacity. Now I think we'll be able to easily predict what will be the unit of molar heat capacity. Quick. Molar heat capacity unit. Instead of taking so much efforts to type, you can actually unmute yourself and speak, guys. For at least for these kind of things, like you have to put some symbols, powers, exponents, and all that. What is the unit of mass heat capacity? Yeah, correct. So it's going to be joule per mole per Kelvin. Yes, correct. Right. So now the only difference here between the last one here, instead of kgs, I'll be using per mole because I'm using number of moles again. So right? So again, it's going to be joule per Kelvin per mole, right? So that would have been the unit of, unit of molar heat capacity. Okay, so we'll take some time, people. We'll take some time to define this heat capacity, molar heat capacity. Please check down the definition. I'm going to dictate a definition for molar heat capacity. Please check down. Right. It is the amount of heat required. It is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature. To raise the temperature of 1 mole of a substance. To raise the temperature of 1 mole of a substance by 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius. By 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius. Okay, I repeat the statement. It is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 mole of a substance by 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius. Now, I think if you read the statement and if you look at the formula here, which I've given you, I think it makes sense, right? So when the number of moles is 1, when the change in temperature is 1, what happens? Q becomes equal to C, right? So that's what I told here, right? So when the number of moles is 1, when the change in, when you want to increase or decrease the temperature by 1 degree Celsius or 1 Kelvin, the Q actually becomes equal to the heat capacity. Right? That's why we say it is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of a substance, 1 mole of a substance by 1 Kelvin or 1 degree Celsius. Now, if I had to define what is mass heat capacity, everything will be same, but instead of 1 mole of a substance, I would have given 1 kg of a substance. That's the only difference it would have been for the definition point of view. Okay, right? So now that we have defined it, now let me ask you a question, right? Let me make a page. Okay. Now, say I have two bodies, A and B. I have two substances or two compounds, A and B, right? Say one is having a heat capacity of 5. The other one is having a heat capacity of 10, right? Now, if I ask you, which is a better conductor of heat? Right? Which is a better conductor of heat, A or B? What will be your answer? These are heat capacity values, C values. Okay, right? Now I'm asking you, which is a better heat conductor? What will be your answer? Maybe in the chat box, or you can unmute yourself and speak. Yeah, there's something in the chat box, B. Okay, fine. Anybody wants to, okay? Okay, we'll take a vote actually. Okay, so we'll take a vote. Two votes for B, one vote for A. Okay, others. Quick, I want everybody to participate. Tell me whether it's B or A. Okay, again, two and two. Then. Okay, 3 and 2. I think there's one more or two more people left. Okay, so 3 and 3. One more. I think there are 8 people totally. Yeah, done. So now you have more votes for, I think equal votes for A and B, I guess, right? So anyways, anybody wants to give me an explanation of why you said that answer? Why B or why A? I will start with A. Anybody wants to give this thing? What is that? A reason for that? It might or might not be correct. Yeah, tell me, Kana.
Maybe because the amount of heat, minimum heat required is less.
Okay, I understand what you're trying to tell. Okay, fine. What about B? Anybody wants to give a reason? Nobody? Okay, fine. So now then let me give my answer. Right, my answer, oh wait, there is something. has more heat. Not exactly. Okay, fine. Anyways, let me give my answer. My answer, which is a better conductor of heat? A is going to be a better conductor of heat. Okay, now why? How? Is all the questions will be popping in your mind. Let me address that. So please understand this. Let's look at now, how did you define your C value? We defined your C value, we defined the heat capacity as the amount of heat required to raise the temperature by 1 degree Celsius. Obviously, if I need to have 1 mole of that particular substance, 1 mole of A should be there. If I have assumed that I have 1 mole each of A and B, right? Now, what I see here is that for me to increase the temperature by 1 Kelvin for A, I require 5 joules. Is it not? Looking at the value, like looking at the C value, I can tell that, right? What is heat capacity? It is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature by 1 Kelvin. So for raising the temperature of A by 1 Kelvin, I require 5 joules. But for the same thing, if you want to raise the temperature of B by 1 Kelvin, you actually require 10 joules, right? So obviously with lesser amount of heat itself, you are able to increase the temperature. That is actually a better heat conductor, right? So obviously A is a better conductor of heat, right? So from this, what you understand is the heat capacity values, right, are inversely related to the heat conductivity or heat sensitivity of that particular material, right? So more and more is heat capacity means for the rise in temperature, you have to give more amount of heat. If you have a less value, smaller value of heat capacity means only small amount of heat is required for the same increase in temperature, right? So this particular statement, you can actually appreciate, right? More and more is heat capacity, less and less would be the heat sensitivity or heat conductivity of the particular substance. Okay, right? So this is also I want to tell you, right? Now, this heat capacity, right, actually is going to depend upon what type of gas I have. Now, again, we are actually in the entire chapter, people, in the entire chapter of thermodynamics, at least in the first and the third part, that is your first law, zeroth law, second law, and third law, right? Actually, we will restrict our discussion only to gases, right? Solids and liquids will not even see. Right? Why? Because it is pretty complex out there. When I go for solids and liquids, the heat transfer is actually pretty complex. But for gases, it is easier to work with. Right? Maybe when you go for higher levels of chemistry, higher levels of physics, maybe, right? Maybe you will be dealing with liquids and solids also. Okay? Right? So what I'm trying to tell you is that this heat capacity, which I have here, right, is actually going to depend upon what kind of gas I have. Okay? Say for example, if I have a monoatomic gas, right, there'll be one value. If I have a diatomic gas, some other value. If I have a polyatomic gas, some other value, right? It actually depends, it actually depends on the atomicity of the gas. Okay, right? Now let me tell you this. This heat capacity is also proportional to the atomicity of the gas. Right, that means a monoatomic gas will have a lesser heat capacity, a diatomic gas will have little higher heat capacity, and more and more is atomicity, polyatomic gases will have a very high value of heat capacities. Okay, say for example, if I want to compare helium, say H2 and ammonia, right? So now obviously helium is a monoatomic gas, this is a diatomic gas, this is a polyatomic gas. Now if you compare the heat capacity values, they will actually be in this order. Ammonia will have higher than H2 than helium. Helium will have the least heat capacity. Okay, now if you want to go in depth on why this happens and see why this happens, actually I can help you with that. Right? So for this, we have to understand that the atoms which are there present in a substance, right, they will undergo constant motions, constant type of motions, right? So like these motions can actually be categorized into three types, right? So one are what are called as translatory motion, or this is your famous linear motion, right? right? So the first one is what is called as translatory motion. The other one, the other two are going to be rotational and vibrational motions. Okay, right? So translational, rotational, and vibrational motions are the three types of motion any atom can undergo. Okay, not any atom. There are certain restrictions. Say, when I have a monatomic gas, I can have only translational motion. But if I have a polyatomic gas, all three types of motions are possible. Okay, right? Fine. So now let me go into this translational, rotational, and vibrational motion. Hope you understand what do you mean by translatory, rotational, and vibrational motion. Translation is straight line, rotation going in circles, and vibration is vibration. Like, I hope you understand standard harmonic motions, SHMs. Right. Okay. So people understand when I think I have to add a page better. Right. Now, all these are connected in the sense the heat capacities, the types of motion, the atomicities, actually, all these are connected. Okay. Now, let me tell you how. Right. Now, please understand, people, when I have a monoatomic gas, right? So when I have a monoatomic gas, it can have only translational motion, right? Now, obviously, because for rotational motion, vibrational motions are going to be with respect to the neighbors, okay? With respect to the neighbors, how it happens, that's how I'll be able to get it, right? So when I have a diatomic gas, I can have translational motion, I can write TR, and I can have rotational motions also. Right. And when I have more than that, any polyatomic gas, I have all three types of motion. Please remember this. Okay. So for a monoatomic gas like helium, xenon, all these things, right? So I have only translatory motion present for these kind of molecules. Right? Not molecules, atoms, they are monoatomic gases, right? And when I have a diatomic gas, translational motion as well as rotational motion is possible. And for a polyatomic gas, all three motions are possible. Okay. Right now, actually, in the previous page, I told you a statement, and the statement was I told you that the heat capacity is directly proportional to the atomicity. Like if you can see here, right, it's directly proportional to the atomicity. Now, since you know about the motions, I can also tell that this is going to be directly proportional to the amount of motions. Right, it is also going to be proportional to the amount of motions present in the amount of movements present in the atom, right? Present in the molecule for that matter, right? Now, usually I can understand atomicity and their amount of motion are actually directly proportional. Monatomic has only one type of motion, diatomic has two, and polyatomic gases have all the three types, right? So, either you can tell like this, heat capacity is directly proportional to the atomicity, or I can even talk in terms of the amount of motions I can have, right? Okay, now keeping that in mind, when I go to the next page, right? Okay, now keeping this in mind, now obviously each of these type of motion, translatory motion, rotational motion, and vibrational motion, they are actually going to contribute certain values, right? They're going to contribute certain values to the heat capacities. Okay, and before I move on to that, I actually forgot one main thing to tell you, one important thing. So this molar heat capacity, right, the heat capacity C, which I have, right, actually can be of two types. In the sense, at what conditions I measure this heat capacity, that also matters. Okay, so hope you know that I have something called as CV, right, and I have something called as CP, right? So this is a molar heat capacity at constant volume, and this is at constant pressure, okay? Please remember this. There can be two types of molar heat capacity. Now, there's not like two types. It just depends on at what conditions you measure the heat capacity. Accordingly, the name of the heat capacity will change. If you measure the heat capacity at constant volume conditions, now it is going to be called as molar heat capacity at constant volume, Right. If you are going to measure the heat capacity at constant pressure, then it is going to be called as molar heat capacity at constant pressure, Cp and Cv. Okay, so this alone I wanted to tell you, and this can actually be related. There is something called as Mayer's relationship. I think you would have even did a derivation in your lower classes, maybe, right? Mayer's relationship is nothing but Cp minus Cv is equal to the universal gas constant R. Right. Please remember this also. This will be a very useful relationship, right? So the Cp minus Cv, the difference between Cp and Cv is equal to R. Okay, now this R value will again be different for, like, depending on what type of units you use for Cp and Cv. If you use the unit in terms of joules, right, my R value is going to be 8.314. Right, and if I use the unit in terms of calories, right, then the R value is 2. Please remember this also. Okay, R, now not only for this, even when you go for your gas loss, your ideal gas equation, so you must have seen that there are going to be, I think you know only two values possible, that is 8.314 and 0.0821. Right, now there is also one more way, one more unit. If you use calories, right, then I can use the R value as 2. Approximately, actually the value is 1.98 something, right? So approximately you can use it as 2. Okay, so this is what I forgot to tell you. There are two things, Cp and Cv, and the relationship between them, right? Okay, now coming back to the motions, right? So this translational, rotational and vibrational motions are going to contribute certain values to the Cp or Cv value. Okay, now actually I'll be able to predict, like, I don't even I'll be able to predict what will be the Cv value or a Cp value if I know what type of gas it is, whether it's a polyatomic gas or a monatomic gas or for a diatomic gas, right? I actually will be able to predict the Cp or Cv value. Now, how will I be able to predict? Let me tell you that when you have translational motion, people, right? If I know that a molecule has translational motion, right, now the contribution it is going to give to the Cv is going to be 1.5 R. Right, so for example, if I have only translatory motion in the molecule, that means if I have a monatomic gas and you know that it has only translational motion, I can directly tell you that the Cv value is 1.5 R. See, remember, these are the contributions to Cv. Please understand, we are not talking about Cp. Cp, if you know the Cv value, you know the Cp value already, because you know the relationship, Cp minus Cv is R, right? So please understand, when the translatory motion contributes 1.5 R to the Cv value of the particular gas. So that means if I have a monatomic gas which has only translatory motion, I can blindly say that the Cv value for any monatomic gas is going to be 1.5 R. Again, R value will be different if you are depending on what unit you use. Okay, right? Fine. So now when I have a rotational motion, right? Now rotational motion is going to be 0.5 R. The contribution is 0.5 R to Cv. Okay, now I cannot have a molecule which has only rotational motion. Impossible. Right? If I have rotational motion, definitely it has to be along with translational, or all the three should be there. Right? Say, for example, if I have a diatomic gas, right? In a diatomic gas, what do you see? You see a translatory motion as well as rotational motion is present. Right? So Cv value for a diatomic gas will be what? It has translatory motion, so 1.5 R. And it has rotational motion also, so you have to add it. So 0.5 R will also be added. For a diatomic gas, I can easily tell you that the Cv value will be 2 R. This is my Cv value. Okay, so the contribution from a translational motion, the contribution from rotational motion, both has to be added if it is going to be a diatomic gas. And always you will have the value as 2 R for a diatomic gas. Okay, and at last, that when I have vibrational motion also, that contribution is just R, whole R, one R. to give it like 1 hour. Okay, when I have vibrational motion. So now I think, like, tell me, if I have a polyatomic gas, what will be the CV value? Quick. Please don't go for chats. Just tell me the answer here. When I have a polyatomic gas, what will be the value of CV?
3.
That's it?
R3R.
Right? Yeah. So it's going to be 3R. So it has translational motion 1.5 plus 0.5R for rotational, and for plus R for vibrational, again plus R. So if you calculate for a polyatomic gas, it is going to be 3R. That's the CV value. Okay. Fine. So now I think we can understand those. The previous statements, that is your heat capacity value is directly proportional to the atomicity. Yes. Now what do you see for a monatomic gas is just 1.5R. For a diatomic gas, it's 2R. And for a polyatomic gas, it's 3R. So obviously it changes with the atomicity. And also it also changes with the amount of motion, because you can see more and more is the amount of motion, more and more is the contributions for all the three, and more is the heat capacity value. Right? Okay. So this is the relationship. And now actually, when you combine these two, that is when you combine your CP and CV, and if I write the equation for Q and T, right? So anyways, we'll go to that. Now, guys, any doubts here regarding heat capacities? Right? So I think everything is clear, right? Okay. So now if I rewrite a little for the heat, right? So now we just wrote Q is equal to NC del T. Right, but this C, which I'm talking about, is a sum of two other heat capacities, that is molar heat capacity at constant pressure and at constant volume. Right, so the better way of writing it is NCP del T plus NCV del T. This is a better way of writing the equation, right, including both CP and CV. And obviously, you, depending on how you do the process, in the sense, If you're gonna do the process at constant pressure, this term has no contribution. This term you can make it zero. Doesn't matter. But say if you're gonna do the process at constant volume, then this term will not have any contribution. So you can make it zero. Okay. But if you have none of them, neither constant volume nor constant pressure, then actually you have to take both the things, right? You have to take both the things and sum it up. Then only you can continue with the problem. Like, they will not ask you problems from this, but still, if you face anything, that's how you are going to do it. You are going to do it. Okay, fine. Now, since we talked about motions, now that we know that we have so many types of motion inside the substance, right? Now, obviously, they will have some kinetic energy associated with them. Is it not? Right? I will have, say, now if I take the total kinetic energy, obviously you can have kinetic energies as well as potential energies because of, say, electrostatic force of attraction, or say because of some type of collisions, right? So now if I take the total energy in a system, in a molecule, right? When I take total energy, now say, obviously I'll take the total potential energy, right? Plus the total kinetic energy. Total kinetic energy will be equal to Ke translational plus Ke rotational plus Ke vibrational motion. So if I sum up all the possible energies inside an atom, right? So this total energy of this, when I sum up the potential energies and all the kinetic energy, this is what is called as your internal energy of the system. Okay. And internal energy in your NCRT, they will use U, but we'll be using E directly, capital E. Okay. You can use anything. There is no restriction. You can either use your E or U. It doesn't matter. Right. So if someone asks you from now on, what do you mean by internal energy of the system? You just tell them that it is sum of the total potential energies and the total kinetic energies present inside the molecule. And that is what is called as your internal energy of the system. Okay, right. Now, can I measure this? Can I measure the E value? The answer is no. Right? Because you will have millions and millions of atoms. They'll have so many, like say, we don't even know what type of motion. It is very, like, even if you have a very powerful microscope, the most powerful microscope, you will not be able to actually visualize these things, these type of motions, which I'm saying, rotational, translational, vibrational, all these are theoretical aspects, right? But like, maybe we'll be able to prove them, but not directly. There is no directly, you will not be able to visualize all this under a microscope. That is impossible, right? So what I'm trying to tell you is that you will not be able to find the absolute value of internal energy. Okay, now what will I be able to find is my delta E, right? If there is a change in internal energy, right? If there is a change in internal energy, that actually can be calculated. That can actually be measured. Okay, now, okay, we'll see how to measure them. But the question is, why is it that the internal energy is changing? What are the ways in which I'll be able to disturb this? And what are the ways by which I'll be able to change the values of this potential and kinetic energy of the system? I mean, of the molecules, right? Now, there are two ways of doing it, right? Now, since you're talking about a gas, okay, fine. There are two ways of doing it. One way is by Q, is by supplying some heat, or say by removing some heat from the system. Obviously, if I give some amount of heat, that heat will be taken up by the atoms and they'll move faster, right? So obviously the kinetic energy values will change, right? And obviously if the system loses heat, if its amount of heat is lost, obviously now the speed will become reduced. Again, the kinetic energy value will change. So again, there'll be a change in internal energy. Okay, so one way of changing your internal energy is by supplying heat or by removing heat from the system. That is one of the way. Second way is by doing some work. Okay, either you do some work or you let the gas do some work. Either way, right? Work done by the gas or work done by us on the gas. Okay, again, I repeat. Work done by the gas. Next thing would be work done by someone else on the gas. Okay, so either way, again, you will see that the work done, again, the internal energy is actually going to change, right? So two ways of changing internal energy, either by supplying or losing heat or by doing some work, either the work is done by the gas or the work is done on the gas, like either way, you will have a change in internal energy. Okay, right? Fine. So now I think now that you knew all the three. Now that we don't know much about W, I mean, you know, but again, thinking that you're in 11th class and you know nothing about this, right? So we know delta E and Q now, right? And obviously what you can see is that they're all interrelated now. Delta E, Q, W, all these are interrelated, right? So now I think this is a good time to introduce your first law of thermodynamics, right? So first law of thermodynamics is basically going to be law of conservation of energy. If you want to put it in words, right? It is basically law of, like, it is energy can neither be created nor be destroyed, but can be transformed from one form to another form, right? So that's what we're going to do here also. But if I write the mathematical form of first law, right? If I write the mathematical form of the first law, this is how it goes. I can do it like this. I have delta E is equal to Q plus W. Now, I think this statement will make sense. This, whatever the equation you wrote here, actually makes sense. Now, how it makes sense, the internal energy change can be brought out. You can have change in internal energy either by changing the Q value or by changing the W value. That's what I said here also, right? The internal energy can be changed by either supplying or removing some amount of heat or by doing some work by the gas or on the gas, or say by the system or on the system. Either way, you'll be able to change the internal energy. Okay, right? So this is now in your book, right? In your NCERT textbooks, I'm not sure, they would have given this equation also. Q is equal to delta E plus W. Okay, now what is this? Like if this is true, how can this be true? It is true. That's how it works. I'll tell you how it works. Now, please understand, people, there are actually going to be sign conventions which you are going to be using. Right? Sign convention in the sense, for certain things, Q value will be positive, for certain things, Q value will be negative. Same goes with W, it can be positive or negative. Right? Now, I told you how we are interpreting this statement, right? This statement, I told you, the internal energy can be changed when you have change in heat or you do some work. Either way, I'll be able to change the internal energy. Right? Now, how will I interpret this statement, this mathematical statement? Is pretty simple. The amount of heat given to the gas or amount of heat given to the system can be used in two ways. One, it can change the internal energy, or it can make the system do some work. Pretty simple. Again, I repeat, the amount of heat given to the system. There is some amount of, say, I give some 100 joules of heat, right? Now, out of the 100 joules, say 50 joules is used for increasing the internal energy. Say all these kinetic energy values are changing, right? Or 50 joules is given to the gas and it does some work. Say it pushes the piston up, it undergoes expansion, right? So there are two ways of interpreting, there are two ways of writing the statement and both of them are correct. It's all about how you interpret it. Okay, if you want to put the sign conventions properly, according obviously depending on the situation, right? If you put the sign conventions properly, both of them will absolutely work with no problems. Okay, but we are going to use only one of them, and that one of them is the first one. Delta E is equal to Q plus W is what we will use throughout this chapter, because we have to stick with one thing, right? Even though both of them works, right? I am more comfortable with this, right? And I think I suppose you also become comfortable only with this, because if you can use that, you might become confused there and there. Okay, so no issues. We'll use this equation only. Delta E is equal to Q plus W. Okay, what is the time? 8:15. Okay, fine. So let me introduce you to the work alone, because that's what we don't know, right? So let me introduce you to work, right? Right. So people, in thermodynamics, at least we know work, we know what is work, right? It is some amount of energy spent in doing some work, right? We know what is work, some action, right? Okay. So this, what kind of work we are going to deal with in thermodynamics is that we are going to deal only with expansion and compression work only, nothing else. Right? You can ask me, sir, what about electrical work? What about mechanical work? No, we are not going to deal with any of that. Now we are going to deal with only gases, right? So again, we know gases can undergo expansion and compression, right? So we are going to deal only with expansion and compression work. Or in other words, I can even tell you that it is going to be, or specifically, it is going to be PV work. Pressure volume work is what we are interested in. Okay. Right. Now, let me derive a statement. Let me derive an equation for you for work. Right. So we know work is actually going to be minus F dot S, or okay, fine. We'll just keep it as now for now, just positive. Right. F dot S basically force into displacement. Correct. Right. Dot product. Okay. So now since we are using, see, like in most of the cases, what will you see is that there'll be a vessel, it'll have a piston and it'll have some gas molecules present, and you are going to do something, say I'm going to heat it, or I'm going to say add some 1 kg mass, something will do, right? Either expansion or compression will happen, right? So mostly we'll be dealing only with this kind of systems here in our syllabus. Okay, so accordingly, I'll be able to make a mathematical equation with this, right? Okay, now please understand, people. The force can again be written in terms of pressure, right? So I hope you know this. Pressure is equal to force by area, right? So if I want to know what is this force will be pressure into area. So can I write that here, right? So area in the sense here, the area of the piston, right? The area of the piston is what you're talking about, right? So the pressure into the area, right? And I have a very small distance also, right? So basically this distance is the distance which is going to move when it undergoes compression or it undergoes expansion, right? So obviously that change in length of the piston is what is the displacement here, right? Now I can even talk it in terms of, say, instead of this, I can even write length or whatever it is. Right now, please understand, this area into length is going to become what? This area into length is going to become volume. Right now, obviously, I will not be able to use directly L. It is actually a small change in length, is it not? There'll be a very small change in length to be delta L or delta S. Right. So area into the small change in length will become small change in volume. Now, what you see? Actually, I have a negative sign here, people. Please, I didn't include that. Now I can include it, right? So W, I will be able to write like this wonderfully. I can write it as minus P external into change in volume. Very, 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 very important. mathematical equation, right? So W, the work done. Either, again, I'll tell you whether it's by the gas or on the gas, that will come later. So now what is the formula? Formula is minus P external. Now it's very, very important. A lot of times I see people doing mistake here. Change in volume, yes, change in volume of the gas. That's okay. But this P, pressure you keep here, is not the pressure of the gas, right? It is the external pressure you supply. What is the external pressure you supply here? That pressure value only you're going to substitute it there. Okay, so this pressure is going to be equal to minus P external del V. Okay, and I think it's almost, yeah, we have 10 more minutes. Okay, so this P external is equal, W is equal to minus P external del V. Okay, now what we'll do is, in this 10 minutes, let me complete the sign conventions. Right, so sign convention we'll have for Q as well as for W, right? Now, where you have to use a positive value, where you have to use a negative value, that alone I'll tell you, right? So please understand, people, whenever you see heat is added to the system, say I say like 50 joules of heat, I would say a system is heated with 50 joules of heat, right? So what do you mean by that? Basically, 50 joules of heat is given to the system. Right. So whenever you see that kind of case, that Q value there will be a positive value. Right. So in your first law equation, the Q value where to substitute is plus 50 because you are given 50 joules. OK, now whenever you see that the heat is lost. Right. Now, in that case, it should be a negative value. Say if I say that gas is cooled down, so that 50 joules of heat is lost. Right, now in that case, when you go to the first law and we want to substitute the value of Q is minus 50. You have to be very, 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 very careful, people, with the sign convention, because if you're going to do that, the entire problem goes wrong. Be very, very careful. Heat added is positive. Heat lost is negative. Okay, now next thing, when I come to W, right, now W, right, now how will I put it is work done, sorry guys, once again, right, now work done by the system is negative, okay, and work done on the system is positive. Okay, now actually we have to spend some 2-3 minutes in understanding this. What do you mean by the system? What do you mean by on the system? Work done by the system and work done on the system. Okay, now let me ask you this. Okay, let me take a situation. Okay, right, say I have a piston gas and gas arrangement. Okay, fine. Now, what happened is, I had a 1 kg mass on top of this. Okay. Now, it's in equilibrium, right? Now, tell me, what do you mean by it's in equilibrium? Equilibrium in the sense the piston is not moving, right? Now, what is the condition in which this piston will not move? Since you have learned physics, can you tell me what will be the condition there? I have 1 kg mass on top of the piston and inside I have a gas, right? So tell me, what is the condition by which I'll be able to tell that this is in equilibrium, in the sense the piston is not moving? What is the condition there? Yes, anybody? What is the condition there for the system to not to move?
Pressure or volume remains constant.
Pressure or volume becomes constant. Okay, I would say some partially correct, right? So what you understand is, I am going to have some pressure of this gas, right? And obviously this 1 kg mass is also going to put some pressure, right? So one pressure coming from top, one pressure coming from bottom, only if these two pressures are same. Oh God, what is wrong? Okay, anyways, so the pressure of the gas and the pressure of the pressure applied by the 1 kg mass, only if it is same, then I can say that this is at equilibrium, right? The piston is not going to move, right? Now what I do is, this is an equilibrium. Now I'm actually, what I'm going to do is that I am going to supply some heat to this. Okay, now when I supply some heat, what will happen? You tell me. When I supply some heat, what will happen to this arrangement?
Pressure of the gas increases.
Okay, pressure of the gas increases. So what happens? So?
Gas will expand.
Okay, gas will expand. So obviously, so basically the piston will move up. Correct? Right? So the gas is going to expand. So you're going to, basically you have given some heat. So the molecules are actually going to take up that heat and it is going to hit this piston with a greater force, right? This piston, it is going to hit with a greater force. So obviously the piston is going to move up and the gas is going to expand. Okay. Now the question is, right? Who is doing work here?
The system.
Yes, obviously the system, in the sense the gas is the one which is moving, the gas is the one which is actually doing some work, right? Now how can I tell this? Because the gas is moving, the gas is expanding against this 1 kg mass, is it not? The gas is moving against this 1 kg mass, right? It is pushing the 1 kg mass against that, it is doing some work and it is undergoing expansion. Right. So please understand, in the simplest way I can put it, whenever expansion happens, right, whenever expansion happens, right, that's actually a case where the system does work, right, and that work will always be negative, right? And whenever you see that compression is happening, so let me give you this situation now. Say I had a piston arrangement, right? Now say I had a 1 kg mass already. Now I'm going to add one more 1 kg mass, right? Now system, like before when I added this second 1 kg mass, system was in equilibrium. Okay. Now when I put the second 1 kg mass, now obviously the piston will move down, the compression of the gas happens. Correct. Now tell me, who is doing work here in this case? Oops. Right. Who is doing work here?
Some other external agent.
What is that agent?
The piston.
No, it's not the piston. It's the mass which you added, right? The mass is actually doing the work. The mass blocks. The mass you are adding here. This is 1 kg. This is another kg. So the mass is actually the one who is pushing the piston down. Right? So in this case, who is doing work? The masses are the one which are doing work. In previous case, who does work? The gas was the one which does work. Right? Okay. So now I can tell you that this is pretty easy now. So whenever compression happens, right? That'll always be a case where someone is doing work on the system. Right? And whenever expansion happens, that will always be a case where the system does work, and that is negative. And whenever compression happens, that is going to be positive. Okay. So you have to remember the sign conventions for both your heat as well as W. It's pretty simple. Expansion means negative, compression means positive. Okay. You can even use the formula if you want. If you use the W is equal to minus P external del V. And if you see for this del V, if it's for expansion, what happens? If it's expansion, the final volume is higher than the initial volume. So del V is positive, right? But what about the overall work? Overall work will still be negative only, right? So whenever you go for compression, the del V value is negative. So negative into negative will become positive. So obviously now whenever compression happens, the work is positive, right? So either way, whatever the way you want to do it, let's remember that all these things, sign conventions of both your Q as well as W must be remembered. And the first law also we saw today. So today we have learned quite a lot of things, right? So next class, it's a very small part I have to complete for the first part, and then we'll go for thermochemistry. And we have obviously will do some problems. Okay. Any questions, people? Any questions on whatever we saw today or from the previous chapters, chemical bonding, general organic chemistry, anything you have?
No, sir.
Okay. So there are some chats. A pressure constant gas. Okay. Yeah, you're answering these questions. I didn't see. Okay. So thank you, people. Right. We'll meet tomorrow and we'll continue with this. Right. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.